Yo, what's up, y'all? Closey back to hit you with another joint. Kind of about political, you know what I'm saying? Also about black history, African history. We're gonna get deep into that too. In this land and, you know, worldwide, you know what I'm saying? So we're dropping videos just like that. Once a day, you know, blessed to be out here. You know what I'm saying? Hopefully y'all enjoying y'all day too and doing something productive and positive for our people, man. Because, you know, the stuff we've been going through right now, we can have it. You know, we really need to start rebuilding our infrastructure and things of that nature. Stores, you know, having self-pride. The thing we're going to go through today is this, though. We're going to talk about Martin Luther King's book, this fifth book, Chaos of Community. Where do we go from here? Chapter 2, when he talks about black power. And just to give a thing on how he felt about it. The backdrop of the story is this. Meredith, James Meredith was going on a march, going on down to Ole Miss in Mississippi. So on the way down there, a sniper took him out and shot him. So while this, what has happened, he made it back to Memphis in the hospital. And in the hospital, Martin King, Stokely Carmichael, Cleveland Sellers, a lot of people like that from SNCC. You know, we got Stokely Carmichael, Cleveland Sellers, from SNCC. You know, Corps, Fred McKinnon's Corps. They all came out here and visited him and stuff like that. So they continued the march. So during the continuance of the march, a lot of young activists didn't really want to be down with the white folks no more, or down with the white liberals. And King gave a reason for this in the second chapter called Black Power. He gave a reason for this, stating that because Lyndon Baines Johnson, in the speech of We Shall Overcome, gave props to James Reed. This is the song that I want to dedicate. He gave props to James Reed, the Unitarian minister, and put flowers on his grave and all type of stuff like that. The black kid, Jimmy Johnson, who got gunned down, didn't get nothing. So it made the black, you know, even back then, white lies took precedence over black lies. Still, you know what I'm saying, nothing really much changed. You know, you gotta look at the seven constants, what he said. So on the way through this march, the chant of Black Power slogan started. Just where this march just started, the Black Power slogan. You want to make sure to get the thing down to the slogan started. So, and this is in Stokely Carmichael SNCC territory in Greenwood, Mississippi. So, it was a competition between in the crowd between Black Power and Freedom Now. This oppressed the press. That's why you really can't trust the press. You know, that's why it's good. We got to have, you know, forums like this. Sense the divide and try to go in for the attack. You know what I'm saying? That's according to King. So, but we're going to get into this. And I'm going to start off right about there. And in the conversation they had in Meredith, Mississippi, you know. Not Meredith, Mississippi, excuse me, Greenwood, Mississippi. And that's where we're going to start in chapter 2 at. You know. And that's where we're going to start chapter 2 at. By the way, on another thing too, this is the Dr. King that they really don't show. And he gives his, in this thing, he gives his definition of black power and what black power is. You know what I'm saying? He gonna break it down. This book is Chaos of Community. Where do we go from here? Chapter 2. You know, and this is the King they really don't show. Okay, so we're gonna start on page 29. Okay. At the Hughes Mass meeting that night, which held in City Park, Stokely mounted the platform and addressing the crowd, arousing the crowd with a powerful attack on Mississippi justice. He claimed, "We need black power." So Greenwood turned to be the arena for the birth of black power slogan in the civil rights movement. Slogan. For people who've been crushed so long by white power, it had taught that black was degrading. It had a ready appeal. Immediately, however, I had reservations of this use. I, M.L.K., had a deep feeling that it was an unfortunate choice of words for a slogan. A fair competition between those with the Black Power slogan and those with the Freedom Now Speakers on each side sought desperately to get the crowds to chant their slogan the most. Sensing the whiting split in our ranks, I asked Stokely and Floyd to join me for a frank discussion on the problem. This is Martin Luther King. For 5 hours, I, Martin Luther King, pleaded with the group to abandon the Black Power slogan. It was my contention that a leader has to be concerned about the problem of semantics. Wordplay. Because that's all semantics is. While the concept of legitimate Black Power might donately sound, right? While the legitimacy of Black Power might donately be sound, the slogan Black Power carries wrong connotations. I mentioned the implications of violence that press have already attacked the phrase. Stokely replied by saying that the question of violence versus nonviolence was irrelevant. The real question was the need for Black people to consolidate their political and economic resources to achieve power. Power, he says, is the only thing that is respected in this world, and we must get it at any cost. And then he, Stokely, looked at me, MLK, squarely in the eye and said, Mark, you know as well as I do that practically every other ethnic group in America has done this. The Jews, the Irish, the Italians did it. Why can't we? And Martin Luther King rebuttal saying, this is just the point. I, MLK, answered, no one has ever heard the Jews publicly chant a slogan of Jewish power, but they have power. Through group unity, number one, this is Martin Luther King speaking, determination, self-determination, and creative endeavor, they have gained it. This is exactly what we must do, I said. We must use every constructive means to amass economic and political power. This is the kind of legitimate power we need. We must work to build racial pride and refute the notion that Black is evil, ugly, and must come through a program. But this must come through a program, not through mere slogan. Stokely and Floyd insisted the slogan itself was important. How can you rouse people around to unite around a program without a slogan such as a rallying cry? I considered the fact that we must have slogans, but we must have one that will not confuse our allies and isolate the Negro community and give more prejudiced whites who might otherwise be ashamed of their own anti-Negro feelings an excuse for self-justification. So he was about allies. Why not use the slogan Black Consciousness or Black Equality? I, Martin Luther King, suggested these phrases would be less than vulnerable and would have more accurate description of what we're about. So he wanted Black Consciousness, Black Equality. He didn't want the term Black Power, the slogan Black Power. The word Black and Power together gives an impression that we are talking about Black domination rather than Black equality. Stokely responded, well, neither would have ready appeal. Stokely responded, neither would have ready appeal. And the persuasive forces of Black Power, Stokely concluded by saying with candor, Martin, I deliberately decided to raise this issue on the march in order to give it Black Power a national forum. So Stokely purposely came down on the march, on the Meredith March, to give Black Power a national forum. So that's what Stokely said to King. Martin, I deliberately seen in order to get Black Power and force you, MLK, to take a stand for Black Power. I laugh. I've been used before. You know what I'm saying? So Stokely came down there, Martin Luther King's march, when they all at the Meredith got shot, came on down there and say he forced MLK to take a stand on Black Power. In the final attempt for unity, I suggest that we compromise by not chanting either Black Power or Freedom Now for the rest of the march. Every revolutionary movement has its peaks, a united activity that will always valleys of debate. In eternal confusion, this debate we must have been little more than healthy internal differences of opinion. But the press, since it loves sensationalism, in every drama there has to be an antagonist. If there's not, the press will find one and build one. Now, this is from Martin Luther King, gotta watch the press. The press ain't, you gotta understand, the press is the propaganda wing, you know what I'm saying, of the madness. You know what I'm saying? So its job is to keep you confused. That's why you gotta do some research. Since black power means different things to different people, and indeed being essential in an emotion concept, it can mean different things to some person on different occasions. It's possible to attribute the ultimate meaning to the single individual organization. One must look beyond the personal styles, the verbal flourishes, and the hysteria of the mass media to assess its values, and to assess its likable honesty, its assets and liability honesty. Right? First, it was necessary to understand that black power is a cry of disappointment. Born from the wounds of despair and disappointment, it's a cry of clarity, clearly hurt, and persistent pain. For centuries, the Negro have been caught up in the tentacles of white power. Many Negroes have given up the faith in the white majority because white power, with its total control, had left them empty-handed. So in reality, black power is a reactionary to the failure of white power. More than 50 Negro churches have been bombed or burned in Mississippi in the last 2 years. Yet the bombers still walk the streets surrounded by a halo of admiration. This is white power in its most brutal and cold war, vicious form, violence. In frustration, it is further led by the fact that even whites and blacks die together in the cause for justice and the death, and a white person gives more attention in the concern of the death of the black person. In Alabama, Jimmy Lee Jackson, Negro, was killed when James Reed, a committed Unitarian white minister, was killed. They, the Negro people, remember how Johnson sent flowers to the gallant Mrs. Reed in an elegant "We Shall Overcome" speech, paused to mention that one person, James Reed, already died in the struggle. The parents of Jimmy received nothing from President Johnson. The failure to mention Jimmy Jackson, the Negro, only reinforced the impression that white America, the life of a Negro, is insignificant and meaningless. Nothing much changed. And only enforced the impression that white America, the life of a Negro, is insignificant and meaningless. Now, 60, 70, ain't nothing much changed. Page 34. There is also great disappointment with the federal government and its timidity to amending civil rights laws to the statutes. Millions of Negroes are frustrated and angry because the extravagant promises made a little bit more than a year ago are a mockery today. Now, this is Dr. King. When the 1965 Voting Rights Law was signed, it was proclaimed the dawn of a new freedom, and an open door to opportunity. It was mainly required under the bylaw, was in appropriate hands of registrars and thousands of federal marshals. Indeed, fewer than 60 registrars were appointed, and not a single federal officer capable of making arrests was sent into the South. As a consequence, the old way of life, economic corrosion, terrorism, murder, he called it terrorism, economical terrorism, murder, the inhumane concept, contempt, that's continued unabated. This is out of our basic reason why black power advocates express contempt for the legislative process. Yeah, they had the laws in the book, but they ain't got to follow the laws. Who said they got to follow them? They wrote the laws. The disappointment mount as they turn to the eyes to the north. In northern states, unemployment, housing discrimination, and slum schools mock the Negro where he tries to hope. The economic plight of the masses of the Negroes has worsened. The gap between the wages of the Negro worker and those of the white worker has widened. Slums are worse, and Negroes attend thoroughly segregated schools today than in 1954. So he said the 1954 decision was another farce. It's page 35. Black power advocates are disenchanted with the inconsistencies of the materialistic posture of our government. Over the last decade, we've seen America applauding nonviolence when the Negroes have practiced it. That's okay? So they applauded, you know what I'm saying? They have watched it being a sit-in movements in the 1960s and the Freedom Rides in 1961 and the Albion Movement in 1962, the Birmingham Movement in 1963, and the Selma Movement in 1965. But then these are the same black young men have watched as America send black young men to burn the Vietnamese with napalm, to slaughter men, women, and children, and they wonder what kind of nation is this that applauds nonviolence whenever the Negro faces white people in the United States, in the streets of the United States, but then applaud violence and burning death when these are the same Negroes sent in the fields of Vietnam. Think about that. You know what I'm saying? Think about that. You know what I'm saying? The white man applauds you when he does nonviolence. According to Dr. King, he said, the white man applauds you when he does nonviolence in America. He applauds that. But he send you overseas to Iraq, Afghanistan, or what they're doing in Yemen, Africa, whatever, whoopie whoop. He tell you, kill him. You be the greatest. Go do this. You know what I'm saying? So you know, you just like you the white man's dog. That's crazy. Think about it. You know what I'm saying? Because you said he's still into terrorism. And he said a white man applauded. All right. When nonviolence came down. All right, let's get into page 35. All this represents disappointment lifted to the astronomical proportions. It is disappointing when timid white Americans, white moderates who feel they can set a timetable for the Negro freedom. It is disappointing with white legislators who could pass laws on behalf of the Negro they never intended to implement. This is disappointment when the Christian church that appears to be more white than Christian. This is disappointing with some Negro clergymen who are more concerned about the size of their whale base on their cars than the quality of service to the Negro community. This is disappointing when whole Negro middle class that has forgotten the stench of black waters where their brothers and sisters are still drowning. Second, black power in its broad and positive meaning is a call for black people to amass among political and economic power to achieve legitimate goals. So in the second term, black power, and the second thing, the definition he had for black power in this broad and positive meaning, is a call for black people to amass economic and political strength to achieve legitimate goals as a collective. No one can deny that Negroes in dire need of this kind of legitimate power. Indeed, one of the great problems that the Negro confronts is his lack of power. The plantation and ghettos were created by people, by those who had power, both to confine those who had no power and perpetuate their powerlessness. By problem of transforming the ghetto is therefore a problem of power. Confrontation between the forces of power demanding change and the force of power abdicating to preserve the status quo. Power properly understood is the ability to achieve purpose. It is the strength required to bring about social, political, and economic change. In this, power is not only desirable, but necessary in each order to implement the demands for love and justice. There is nothing essentially wrong with power. The problem is that American power is unequally distributed. This has led the American Negro, the Negro American, in the past to seek their goals through love and moral persuasion, devoid of power, and a white American seek their goals through power, devoid of love and consciousness. Yeah, they don't have no conscience. In his struggle for racial equality, the Negro must seek to transform his condition of powerlessness into creative and positive power. The most obvious sources of power is political. Ours is the development of political awareness and strength in the Negro community. The election of black in key positions and the use of the voting bloc to liberalize the political climate and achieve on our just aspirations for freedom and human dignity. To the extent that black power advocate these goals, it is a positive and legitimate call to action that we in the civil rights movements have sought to follow all along and which we must intensify in the future. So he agreed with this aspect of black power. You know what I'm saying? He said that's what he's fighting for all along. So he basically can see the point, you know what I'm saying? Saying that, yes, you know, black power is what we're fighting for all along. Read again. You know what I'm saying? Read again. One of the obvious sources of power, this is page 37. Just so you know, book Chaos and Community, Martin Luther King's fifth book, Chaos and Community. Where do we go from here? One of the most obvious sources of power is political. I urge the development of the political awareness and strength in the Negro community to elect blacks to key positions and the use of the voting bloc to liberalize the political climate and achieve on our just aspirations for freedom and human dignity. To the extent that Black Power advocate these goals, it is a positive and legitimate call to action that we in the civil rights movement have sought to follow all along, and which we must intensify in the future. So he's saying you gotta intensify Black Power. Page 38. Black Power, this is his third definition, to go according to Martin Luther King about Black Power, is also a calling on pooling of financial resources to achieve economic security. While the climactic answer to the Negro economic dilemma will be found in the Master's Federal Program for the Poor along the lines of A. Philip Randolph's Freedom Budget, a kind of Marshall Plan for the disadvantaged, there is something the Negro can do for himself to throw off the shackles of poverty. Although the Negro is still at the bottom of the economic ladder as a collective, his collective annual income is up to $30 billion. Now, this plan they talking about, this plan, this is the same thing Dr. Carl Anderson kind of put forward to Obama. You know what I'm saying? Many people don't know about that. It's like a Marshall Plan for the Black neighborhood. Go to Dr. Claude Anderson's site. He got it on there. It's pretty good. You know what I'm saying? I read it. It's pretty damn good. So, you know, but this is not really going to happen. This is unfeasible. You know what I'm saying? They're not going to give you a helping hand like that. We got the history to see it. All right. They talking. We reading it right now. Shit, hell. Yeah. Through the pooling of such resources, page 38, back to the book. To pooling of such resources and development habits of thrift and techniques of wise investment, the Negro shall be doing this year to grapple with the problems of economic deprivation. If Black Power means the development of this kind of strength within the Negro community, then it is a quest for basic necessity, legitimate power. Finally, his fourth thing to Black Power. Black Power is a physical call to manhood. So Black Power is also a physical call to manhood, according to Dr. King. The historian Kenneth Stamp, in his remarkable book, The Particular Institution, has fascinating section on psychological indoctrination that was necessary from the master's point of view to make a good slave. Stamp noted five recurring aspects of this training. First was those who managed the slave had to maintain strict discipline. One master said unconditional submission is the only footing on which the slave should be placed. Second, the master felt that they had to implant in the bondsman a consciousness of personal inferiority. This sense of inferiority was deliberately extended to his past. The slave owner was convinced in order to control the Negro, the slave, had to feel that African ancestry tainted them, and that their color was a badge of degradation. The third step in the training process was to awe the slave with a sense of the master's enormous power. The fifth aspect was the attempt to persuade the bondsman to keep interest in the master's enterprise and accept his standards of good conduct. Thus, the master's criteria of what was good and true and beautiful were to be accepted as unquestionably by the slave. The final step, according to stamp documents, was to impress upon the Negro the helplessness to create them in a habit of perfect independence on their master. Here then was a way to produce a perfect slave, accustomed to rigid discipline, demand on him of unconditional surrender, submission, impress upon him the sense of innate inferiority, and develop a paralyzing fear of white men, training to adopt the master's code of good behavior, and instill in him a complete sense of dependence. Page 40. Out of our soul of slavery came psychological roots of Black Power. Any familiar with Black Power movement recognizes the defiance of white authority and white power as a constant thing. The defiance of white authority and white power is a constant thing. The defiance has almost become a kind of taunt underneath it. However, there's a legitimate concern that the Negro will break away from unconditional submission. So they worried that you're going to break that spell off of them. The unconditional submission, according to Dr. King, and thereby assert his own selfhood. So they worried. That's one of their biggest worries. Page 40. Another obvious reaction of Black Power to the American system of slavery is determination in the glory in blackness. and to resurrect our joyous and resurrect joyously the African past. And responsible for the phrase of my master's enormous power, Black Power advocates contend that the Negro must develop his own self, own sense of strength, no longer in fear of awe and obedience to rule. Black Power is a psychological reaction to the psychological indoctrination that has led to the creation of the perfect slave. So Black Power is our way of getting free. Page 40. Those in the Black Power movement who contended that blacks should cut themselves off from every level of dependence upon whites for advice, money, and other health are obviously reacting against the slave pattern of the perfect dependence of the master. While this reaction often led to negative and unresponsive and frequent broader interpretations of the words and action, one must not overlook the positive value in calling the Negro a new sense of manhood into a deep feeling of racial pride and the audacity of appreciation of heritage, of his heritage. Let's read it again, this page 41. While the reaction often led to negative and unreal responses, it has frequently brought the implanted words in action, or one must not overlook the positive value in calling the Negro to a new sense of manhood, and it's into a deep feeling of racial pride and to an audacity appreciation of his heritage. The Negro must grasp by new retaliatory relation of theory of his dignity and self-worth. The Negro must grasp by new realization of the dignity and self-worth. He must stand up amidst a system that still oppresses him and avail of an unassailable and majestic sense of his own value. He must no longer be ashamed of being black. Can't be ashamed of that, baby. The job of arousing manhood within the people that have been taught for many centuries that they are nobody is not that easy. The chapter continues on. You know, I didn't get all of it down. You want to have the book. But that's chapter 2, Black Power. And as you can see, King was for the legitimate aspects of Black Power. Like I said, it's a call to manhood. You know, it's a psychological call to manhood. It's a psychological call to nation building. That's what he's been doing any damn way. You know what I'm saying? He's saying that's what he's been doing anyway. You know, on page 37. The extent that Black Power advocate these goals is a positive and legitimate call to action. So it's a positive, legitimate call to action, Black Power. And that we in the civil rights movement have sought to follow all along, in which we must intensify in the future. The thing is, though, I saw Zelensky talk about this. We're going to have a video on this pretty soon, too. You know what I'm saying? That people is really afraid of power. Our people and self-interest. We got to build these things. This is not the time to play around, people. These people got whispers, man. You know, this is June, you know, 2018. These people got whispers of civil war going off and stuff like that. You know what I'm saying? Hey, we got to find our best interest. Like Dr. Amos Wilson said, who, you know, they might have wrote the law, but the law is only good as they enforce it. If they ain't enforcing the law, then shit, you know, you know, it don't make no difference how much you can spit that stuff at the book. Or like that Trick Daddy song here on Ludacris, you know. You down here with a rope around your neck and you know what I'm saying, Southern Georgia, Northern Florida. And there ain't shit you could do because they wrote all the laws. So, you know, you say you got to break away from that psychological thing. Like Dr. Martin King said that, you know what I'm saying. You know what I'm saying, you got to break away from that psychological thing. You know what I'm saying? That conscience of inferiority. You know what I'm saying? And I said their biggest fear was. You know what I'm saying? Martin King said his biggest fear was to them. They was, you know what I'm saying? There's a legitimate, in page 40, he said, there's a legitimate concern that the Negro break away from his unconditional submission and thereby self his own serfhood. They don't want to see that. You can see it with the little permit patty and stuff like that. They don't want to see them kids assert their own selfhood and stuff like that. So we got to understand this is what it is. So we got to, you know, we got to collectivize and come down. You know, even Martin Luther King, that's part of chapter 2, you know what I'm saying, and how he felt about Black Power. You know, and its positive, legitimate aspect. So, just something for us to think about. You know, he said we're supposed to have racial pride. We're supposed to have group unity. You're supposed to have self-determination. You're supposed to have creative endeavors. Because, you know, we some grateful people. I'm just, hey, when it come back, you know, that's why another reason I'm like, go ahead, tariff. You know, the white politics of the white man is insipid. But fuck it, they gonna tariff. You know what I'm saying? I wanna make sure that's known. The politics of the white man is insipid. But if they gonna tariff, shit, we gonna get creative. You know what I'm saying? And we gonna make money off our shit. We some inventive people. This is a glorious time to be alive. You know what I'm saying? Real talk, because you know what I'm saying? While we collectivizing and building up, this is just a glorious time to be alive. You know what I'm saying? Because we making a quiet cornerstone for future generations. You know what I'm saying? We can't think, you know what I'm saying? I know there's a lot of bullshit, but you know, in the game. But you know, we got to think, you know, far-fetching now. You know what I'm saying? These cats got, what, a 100-year plan? The Chinese or something like that? Asians, they already talking about the Asian century, which you've seen is coming across. Where we gonna fit in that? You know what I'm saying? So we gotta start thinking deep about where we going. Like I said before, prior and earlier in the tape, they talking about civil, like a soft civil war. It was in the USA today. Like, what the hell is this? Shit. Hey, we need to start, like I said, we need to start thinking around them aims. The Democrats ain't no good. The Republicans ain't no good. We just need to start thinking about self-determination for this African nation. Where we can help each other out, you know what I'm saying? Go here, brothers, you know what I'm saying? He's a good standing member. Garvey got a good book on that, not the philosophy of opinions, but African philosophy for leadership, or something like that. That ain't the, you know, it's African philosophy, you know what I'm saying? Where he break down some rules and stuff, you know? Because this is the kind of thing we need, because it's about to get super ugly. You know what I'm saying? It's about to get super, and we need to start getting on some self-interest. You know what I'm saying? Some thing that we got to protect ourselves. We can't be dependent on these other people to do it, because they got to feed their own kids. And not saying we are that type of people either, because we do our thing. But, you know, things we're doing, we can't do it no more. We got to, the game to change. We got to try to, you know, wisen up and smarten up to the game. What you doing anyway? But we got to do it, you know, legit and as a collective. You know what I'm saying? Because it ain't getting no better. All right, well, that was, you know what I'm saying? Hopefully you enjoyed that. Martin Luther King, Black Power. And, that's what's up. Hope you enjoyed it. See you in the next video.